Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My name is Neil Quigley. I'm the Vice-Chancellor of the University. It's my pleasure to welcome all of you here to our first Distinguished Alumni Award of 2018. This award going to Dr. Shane Lee. Shane, it's a great pleasure to have you back here at the University of Waikato and great opportunity for us to connect you up with a number of aspects of your past, including staff from our computer science program, but also other aspects of the Bay of Plenty, Waikato and New Zealand community. As we were talking just before we came in, Shane said, yes, it turned out that this line of work was a really useful and successful career choice, and so it's turned out to be. Shane is obviously a great Bay of Plenty, Waikato, New Zealand success story. It's our great pleasure and a privilege to have Shane here with us today to talk to us. Shane, on artificial general intelligence, over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that introduction. Yeah, it's a real pleasure being back here where I started my research training and seeing so many familiar faces. I just heard there's some students actually from Lakes High, Rotorua, so kia ora. It's great to be back home. I'm going to talk a little bit today, it's just a short 30-minute talk. It's a little bit of a mix of some of my history and some of the things that have happened in DeepMind, some of my voyage. It's quite high level. It's not too technical, so you should just sit back and enjoy the story. So my story begins in Rotorua, where my mother, sitting down there, my parents got together and they found the money to buy me a Dick Smith VZ200 computer for my 10th birthday. It was in 1983, and it fascinated me from the moment I had it. I started programming, I started creating these. There was this world I could create on the screen with little characters that would run around and they could chase each other and do all sorts of things, and I could just bring to life this world, this new sort of playpen, if you like, for me to explore ideas. And in a sense, that never lost me. They left me, rather. That stuck with me for the rest of my life, that fascination of creating things within a computer. And one of the games I had, this is actually a screenshot of the VZ200 Space Invaders. It's funny how these things come back years and years later in my research career. Another thing that I remember that I think influenced me a lot from the early days, I used to read these magazines. There were lots of hobby magazines for people interested in computer programming. And I remember one, I was probably under my bed I should pull it out and scan the actual article. But there was one that had a graph of Moore's Law, and it was showing the exponential increase in compute power over the years. And it's something that I had experienced myself, and because every few years I'd get a new computer system and it would be dramatically more powerful than the last one I got. And so I remember reading this article, and it had this a graph like this, where it had the years across the bottom, and it had the fastest supercomputer in the world measured in FLOPS, which are floating point operations per second, which just means mathematical calculations per second. And the vertical axis is an unusual axis, it's logarithmic. So when you see 1e plus 3, what that means is a 1 and 3 zeros. When you see 1e plus 12, that's 1 and 12 zeros. Okay. So every time you go one rung of the ladder up, you're not just counting up by a fixed amount, you're going 10 times whatever you had at the previous rung, and then 10 times whatever you had at the previous rung. And so when you see these dots here, over time, which looks like a straight line,
it means that the performance of computers over that period of time is multiplying by 10, and then multiplying by 10 again on top of that, and then multiplying by 10 again on top of that, and on top of that, and on top of that. And this article was saying, you know, this was in 1985, imagine if this was to continue into the future. What incredible things would become possible? And I just remember that sticking in my head for many years, and it's still something I think back to now. Anyway, I finished at Lakes High, and I came over here. I started a BCMS degree in mathematics, and during my time here, I was doing very well in the programming course, and I went sort of above and beyond and wrote a symbolic differentiation system, and I wrote a system for doing neural nets and so on. And then there was the Weka project, and they needed somebody as a student, and they thought, well, this guy who's doing all this extra work already would probably be a good person to have. So I joined the Weka project and started working with summers there, and that was really my first taste of research work. And I really enjoyed it, and I really enjoyed the I enjoyed studying and learning about lots of things. When you go to research, it's much more creative now because you're trying to push back the frontiers and really, really do new things. So that is where I started my research career in machine learning. And I find it actually very satisfying today, even when I give new starter talks at DeepMind, and there's sort of 60 or 70 people there, and I ask them who knows the Weka project, and I'll always see five or six hands go up. So it's used throughout universities, teaching all around the world today. Germany and Poland and all over the place. So it's great to see a project from the early 90s that's still very much in use in one world today. So after being at Waikato, I went up to Auckland University and I did a master's degree in mathematics up there, interested in sort of theoretical aspects of machine learning, something called Solomonoff induction. And after a couple of years working there, doing Y2K, which wasn't very exciting, it has to be said, fixing gates for a living, I heard that some of the Weka guys back down here in Hamilton, some of them sitting down there right now, they were involved in this company called IntelliGenesis, which was based in New York. And I thought, that sounds much more interesting than fixing dates. So I got chatting to them and came back down here. And then after a while working in Hamilton, I actually transferred to New York, and that was an amazing experience living in New York. And you know, when you're a boy from Rotorua going to New York, it's kind of a mind blowing experience, I guess. But anyway, it was really cool. Now you probably know what happens next: there's a .com crash. So yeah, that was the end of IntelliGenesis, but it did. It did further the sort of idea in my head that AI is quite an interesting topic, and there's lots and lots of interesting applications going on there. And so I started thinking about what I was going to work on next, now that I was newly out of a job and unemployed. So I went back and I looked up what had been happening in computer performance. And so I've extended this graph now, there's a red circle around it over there. And sure enough, computer performance keeps increasing, multiplying by 10, multiplying by 10, multiplying by 10, on top of each other, on top of each other, on top of each other, over the years. So it's an incredible explosion in computer performance. Now, I don't have a follow-up graph to this in this talk, but if you do continue the graph till today, it does increase following this trend all the way along, which is quite astonishing when you think about it. Anyway, I started thinking about doing a PhD, and I became very interested in the measurement and definition of intelligence, and that was very much related to the work I did at Auckland, and also connected to some of the previous work I was doing here at Waikato. And I found there was a professor in a place called the Itzia in Lugano, Switzerland, part of the Italian-speaking part of Switzerland. It's just across the border from Italy. You can actually see just on the other side of the lake there, a little bit of Italy. And so there's this German professor there, Markus Hüther, and he was working on some ideas very much along the lines of what I was thinking of doing, so I figured if you can't beat him, join him. I was hoping it was a completely new and original idea, but it turns out he was already doing something very similar. But he took me on as a PhD student, and I went to
Uganda for a number of years. So that was a major topic of mine. It was a it's a view I developed that one of the biggest problems in artificial intelligence is actually not simply that we don't know what the solution is, but rather we don't really even know what the problem is. We can't define and measure whether we're making progress towards building a general intelligence system. So I started studying a lot about this topic, and I did a big literature review and collected nearly 100 definitions of intelligence. And what I discovered was that there were sort of clusters of very similar perspectives on the nature of intelligence. And within that cluster, you'll find all kinds of definitions from all kinds of psychologists and other types of researchers. And one of those clusters in particular, I felt, had a very workable definition for the purposes of artificial intelligence. And essentially, it says intelligence is really about breadth. Machines are typically built to do one very, very specific thing, like play chess. Humans are not like that. Humans can learn to do a whole wide range of things. They can learn to play chess, or Go, or poker, or program computers, or write poetry, or speak Mandarin, or ride a bicycle, or it goes on and on and on and on and on. So that's really the distinguishing point of humans. Not exactly built to do any of these specific cognitive tasks, rather we have general capabilities that allow us to learn to do a very wide range of cognitive tasks. And so that's sort of the perspective that I take here on the nature of intelligence. And so it then turns into a measurable thing. If you can construct a test that spans all kinds of cognitive capabilities, all kinds of different tasks, a big rich collection, you can actually start to quantify the intelligence of agents relative to human intelligence by testing humans on those same tasks and start to understand the ways in which your AI might be strong or weak relative to whatever the current state of the art is of your algorithms. So you can turn the whole area into a measurable endeavor, and I think that's really, really important. So during my time in Lugano, I became interested in neuroscience and the connections between machine learning and neuroscience. Because we're starting to discover neuroscience aspects of the architecture of the brain, the main sort of component parts and the type of representations and algorithms and problems being solved by these parts. Now there are many things we don't still know about the brain, but even a partial sketch of a working system like this is very, very interesting from an artificial intelligence perspective. And in some cases, we actually have quite detailed knowledge of the connection between machine learning and what goes on in the brain. So that's the case in vision. There's strong connections between the top vision algorithm, convolutional neural networks, and what happens, what we find in a macaque monkey brain. One that's quite close to home is a reinforcement learning algorithm that the brain has. So this is an algorithm where you have an agent that is acting on the world, and as the agent acts, it gets a signal indicating how well it's doing at that moment in time. So for example, if you're playing a computer game, if the score goes up, you might get a little reward. If the score goes down, you get a little punishment signal. And so by trying to get more and more of the reward signals, choose your actions accordingly, you make the score go up and you do well in the game. Now, the first person to propose the most widely studied and used algorithm in that area, called temporal difference learning, is actually Professor Ian Witten, who's here at the University of Waikato. And my first paper, research paper I ever published while I was with the Weka Group here, I was one of the authors on the paper with him. When I was at the Gatsby unit, my professor there, my supervisor, was Professor Peter Dayan. And he's the guy who discovered that out of BTA and substantia nigra in the brain, the phasic dopamine, which is, comes out of those areas, is actually the temporal difference error needed to implement the temporal difference learning algorithm. So, and this has been very, very carefully studied over the last 15, 20 years. So we now know very precisely that the brain implements a known machine learning algorithm. Opportunity to work with the discoverer of the algorithm and the discoverer of the fact that it is in the brain.
So this sort of thing, of course, is, you know, really, really interesting if you're thinking about building an AI, because it starts giving you a bit of a sketch of, you know, parts of the working system. It allows you to think about what the rest of the system might look like. Anyway, while I was at the Gatsby unit, I met a guy called Dennis Asabas. He had the same supervisor as me, Peter Dayan. And we got talking, and it turns out we were both really, really excited about artificial intelligence and the possibilities that were opening up there, and the idea that this could become a really big thing in 5, 10, 15, 20 years' time. And we thought that it was time to execute on this. Even though most people we talked to said, you know what, artificial intelligence is, you know, treading water a bit, and it's, you know, it's probably very, very, very far off in the future. You see big advances in artificial intelligence. We thought that was wrong, and we thought that the momentum was there for something to be really big coming soon. So we decided that to sort of pursue this dream, we should start a company. This is actually a screen grab I took of our business plan for DeepMind, building the world's first artificial general intelligence. So this is what we were running around talking to investors to get the initial funding for our company. And what made us excited? So there were a few things. First of all was progress in machine learning. Now these days you read about it in the news and things all the time. It's quite a mainstream sort of topic. Back then it wasn't so mainstream, but if you were actually in the field and paying attention to areas such as deep learning, and the Gatsby unit was quite well connected into that community. We have workshops and so on at the Gatsby unit that brought in all the top people in the world in that subject. We could see that there was real progress sort of coming up within a whole range of different fields. And so we felt that these component parts needed to build an interesting artificial intelligence were starting to mature, and the time was going to be right to start bringing them together. Another thing we were very excited about was neuroscience, and the fact that we were starting to find these connections between machine learning and processes that were going on in the brain, and that this could help give us insights into how to bring different algorithms together to build really interesting agents that we could then train and test on a wide range of cognitive tasks as per the perspective of intelligence. Another thing that made us very excited was the incredibly rapid progress in hardware, which I've already talked a bit about. And then finally, we felt that we could define and measure machine intelligence in some meaningful way. And that it would give us some orientation and ability to determine whether we're really making progress towards building an artificial intelligence. So that goes back to my thesis work. So just to come back to this change in compute performance, I think this is quite a nice way to illustrate what's happened. So on the left there, we have a Tau PC, which is a state-of-the-art PC from 1990. And on the right, we have a Tensor Processing Unit that Google produces. It's about that big, from 2017. Now, that state-of-the-art Tau PC that a researcher may have had in 1990 does about 2 million mathematical calculations per second. And that Tensor Processing Unit does 180 trillion. Now, we all know that's a big difference, but sort of to make that more concrete, there's a data set called ImageNet where there's 1,000 different categories of objects. So there will be things like laptops and a flower and a chair and a glass and, you know, a watch and all sorts of things, right? 1,000 different categories of objects. You can train up a neural network to achieve human level or even slightly beyond human level performance using a tensor processing unit in one day. And in fact, if you use a group of them together, as we've done recently, it takes about 30 minutes. But anyway, one tensor processing unit, that's about one day of training to reach human level performance. If we take the same algorithm and try running it, you know, back to the future style and you're already driving back to 1990, hand it to a researcher there and say, here's the algorithm, run it on your state-of-the-art PC, it's about 250,000 years just to train the weights of your network so you can then use it, right? So even if she decided, well, you know, this isn't working, I'm going to go talk to Bob in the supercomputing center
and run the algorithm on a supercomputer, you're still looking at half a millennia just to train the network. So it would have been much faster for her to simply go, right, I now have the algorithm, I'm going to just go on holiday between years, come back and run it overnight. So that is an incredibly profound change to what happens, and it illustrates, you know, back in the day when I was looking at that graph of what if in the future we had all this compute power, well, that's what if. This is the impact it has. So one of the topics we started working on in DeepMind was trying to get algorithms that could play Atari 2600 games. So this was an old games console from the 1980s. And this fits very much with the definition of intelligence that I gave before. So we want one algorithm that can do lots and lots of different things. And we didn't really want to build hundreds of different games and tasks. We are doing that now, but to start with, it was much easier just to get an emulator that we could just get the scans and the ROMs for and just have all the Atari games there. It was good that we didn't make the games because we didn't design the problems to fit the solutions we had. That's always a problem in research. And also, a lot of the games were quite iconic, so when we were explaining to an investor we could do Space Invaders or Pac-Man or something, they already knew what that meant. They were hard, but not too hard. And because we wanted this in a very clean way, the interface is very straightforward. So our software, our artificial intelligence agent, would get the pixels on the screen coming in at 60 hertz, 30,000 color pixels, and it would get a reward signal. I've mentioned reinforcement learning before. So the reward signal, which is simply the change in the score from one time step to the next. So if the score was 100 and went to 107, it would get plus 7 as a reward. And that's it. That's the only information the computer gets, the algorithm, the artificial intelligence gets. It is not told what the game is, it's not told what anything in the game is, it's not told what the objective is. It has absolutely no idea. It just has all these pixels coming at it, and it gets told when the score changes. And what it has to do is decide what to do with this virtual joystick, which is 9 different directions of the joystick, 8 directions in the middle, and then a fire button, so there's 18 different possibilities. And from that, it will give it a little bit of time to start with. It has no idea how to play the game. It's got no idea what's going on. But after you've trained it for a while, it starts playing the game. And so this is what, to begin with, it just loses lives of time. But once it's been trained up, it learns to avoid the bullets, and it learns to line its bullets up so that they hit the ship, the invaders coming down. It dodges out of the way there. It uses the barriers. And it learns that the mothership is very valuable, so sneaks a shot in there, and it gets really, really good at it. Now you can take the same algorithm and you can give it a different game, and it will learn just by experience, not without being told what the game is, what the game's all about. So here's a boxing game, and with some experience, it's figured out what it's meant to do and what it's controlling and so on, and it becomes ridiculously good at playing boxing. So you can take the same algorithm again, and you can give it a different Atari game. This is a car racing game. To start with, it crashes all over the place. Given some more experience, it becomes very, very good at car racing. Much better than people are. Now, to illustrate the generality of this algorithm, not only can it do 50 different games that we have trained and tested it on from Atari, we can take a more modern 3D car racing simulator, take the same algorithm, we actually discretize the pixels to the same resolution as Atari, and we see if we can drive a 3D car racing game. So this is the same algorithm learning to do all of these things, and it becomes, again, very good at doing this. So this is starting to get closer to what I was talking about earlier with humans. Humans have this incredible capability to learn and adapt to do a whole wide range of things. Machines typically don't. They typically can't do that. Here, we're starting to have the beginnings of algorithms that can learn to do lots of different things to quite a high level. So that was considered a major breakthrough. So for those of you who don't know, Nature is probably the most prestigious academic journal in the world. And so it was amazing for us as a small company, we were about 70 people at the time, to not just get a paper into Nature, which is extremely difficult, but actually we landed on the front cover of Nature with that work there. Now, around this time, the whole area was taking off like a rocket, and the people in our company were becoming very valuable people, and they were, and all the big $100 billion companies were trying to pour into the area and try to hire all our people, and so on and so on. It became clear that we really needed to partner with a much larger company and to scale up our efforts much more rapidly with their help. And so we got into discussions with Google, and we found that they had seemed to have a good understanding of what our mission was and what we were trying to achieve. And they've been excellent in supporting us along this journey. So we sold the company to them, and now we've grown DeepMind a lot more since then. And we've kept exactly the same mission. So it's been a really, really good partnership. One of the topics that we took on when we were inside of Go, of Google was the game of Go. It's a very old game, it's about 5,000 years old. It's the most played board game in the world. It's very popular in China and Japan and Korea. It has incredibly simple rules. You have two players, one will play black, one will play white, and you have these stones and you place them on the vertices of the board. And if you surround the stones of your opponent, you capture all that area. And the winner is the player that captures the most area on the board. And that's basically it. There's like one other rule where you can't go back to the state you just did. But that's it, those are the rules of the game. So it's incredibly simple, but it's incredibly complex when you try to play the game, try to figure out what to do, what is the right strategy. And you end up with these really, really rich patterns. And computers were never good at playing this because there were just too many possibilities for the computer to analyze. In a game of chess, you have about 20 different moves to consider, and then for those 20 different moves, there's about 20 different moves your opponent will make, could make. And then for each of those, there's about 20 moves that you could make and apply. With Go, it's more like 200. So when you start trying to look ahead in the game, you're looking at 200 times 200 times 200 times 200 times. And quickly, that will completely overwhelm even very, very powerful computers. So anyway, we applied deep learning to this and had a major breakthrough. We managed to beat the European champion, Fan Hui, and then we went to Seoul to play one of the legends of the game, Nisadol. He's won the most championships of the last decade, and he was in the top five players in the world at the time. Those numbers sort of move around a little bit. Month by month as they win all these different games. Anyway, we played him and we beat him 4-1, which was considered a major, major breakthrough that field. A lot of people thought that was probably 20 years away. That got us on the front cover of Nature again. So that was pretty cool. Now, if you're interested in the story, there's actually a movie about it. I appear for about 20 seconds in it. Because I wasn't directly on the team that was doing this. But it's a really good movie. It's won a whole lot of awards. You can watch it on Netflix and the Apple movie thing and Google YouTube and various other things that's available. And yeah, you don't really have to be into Go or computers to watch it. It's a very human story of a team struggling to do something and having setbacks and facing a famous world champion and how that drama unfolds. So it's a good fun movie to watch. We've still been working on this stuff, and most recently we've developed something called AlphaZero, where we don't even give the AI system any examples of gameplay at all to learn from. It has to actually create its own data by playing against itself, and it starts off with a random play. It has no idea how players came, it just does making random moves. And it looks at whether or not it's winning or losing. And then it learns from those experiences. And so it can self-teach to play all these different games. And we don't just get it to do chess, we get it to do shogi and get it to do and Go as well. So we do all three games there. And within, so what do we got here? In 8 hours, from starting from scratch, not knowing how to play the game, it'll go superhuman at playing Go. And then a number of hours after that, it will be better than the system that the best system that we've ever developed. Within a few hours, it goes superhuman at playing shogi, and within a few hours, it goes superhuman at chess. And in all cases, it's not just superhuman; it's better than any software anyone's ever developed to play these games, which is quite remarkable
So you can see a little bit of the flavor coming out here of, again, developing systems that can learn to do a whole wide range of things and have that sort of generality to them rather than specifically engineering to them to do one very, very specific thing. It's amazing watching it learn to play chess. It actually reinvents all the standard openings from the game. And if you look at the statistics over time, as this strength of its play becomes higher and higher and then starts to become superhuman, it actually starts to discard some of the openings that we use because it starts to look deeper into the game and discover flaws in them. So it both reinvents all our knowledge and then actually surpasses that knowledge all by itself within hours, which is amazing. There's lots of things going on, Dimon. I can't really cover all of them. We have a lot of people. So I'll just mention very briefly just a few of them. You can go to our website and we have blog posts and lots of research papers if you want to sort of get into a bit more of the detail. One thing we did recently was something called WaveNet, where we convert text into spoken word. And again, you know, we used a very learning-based approach to do this. And within, there was a small team of people within a couple of months managed to significantly exceed state-of-the-art in the field that's been going for about 40 years or 50 years, using this learning-based approach and this kind of recipe of, you know, using huge amounts of compute and relying on learning rather than handcrafting. Locomotion, you can learn these very natural controllers for all sorts of walking agents and robot control, all kinds of stuff like that. If any of you are fans of Stephen Colbert in The Late Show, he actually turned up with one of our videos from our website on The Late Show, so it's pretty cool when it turned up on my comedian. Oh, I'm a bit of a fan, so so that was pretty cool seeing him use that. We can do reasoning about scenes. So again, this is not programmed about English, it's not programmed about what any of those objects are. It takes the pixels in, it takes the characters in, you feed it through a neural network, and it actually learns to reason about, interpret what is in the scene, interpret the English, reason about what the English is and how it applies to the scene, and answer the question. It's actually slightly better than humans are doing this. And, you know, if it had been fed a different language, it would actually, if it was in Japanese or whatever, it would do that fine. Because it's not pre-programmed in this particular language. We have agents that run around 3D environments. They learn to see, they learn to navigate, they learn to interpret the instructions up there, and we can give them commands and questions, and they have to go and solve these problems, and they get a reward or punishment according to whether or not they can solve the problems that we present to them. And you can give them all sorts of instructions. And again, it's not, the English or anything is not built into it. If the language was Italian, it would work just as well. But you would have to train it in Italian, it would learn Italian to understand that, to execute this. Now, there are limitations to the language. You can't accept any language, but it is, there is an interesting amount of flexibility to what it can learn to do. Anyway, as I said, there's a huge amount of research going on in DeepMind. Go and look at the website and look at some blog posts or some of the talks that are online if you're interested in delving further into that. So the current state out today, we're about 700 people still growing. I expect we'll be about 1,000 people next year. Hundreds of research papers a year. We've got 4 papers in Nature, 2 in Science, and more coming very, very soon, actually. I'm not allowed to say what it is, but, something very soon. And I think we could justifiably claim to be the world's leading AGI research centre at the moment. So, just before I finish, a few things I've learned along the way. So, the first thing I've learned is the importance of location. And, this is something, I guess it's not entirely good news for here in New Zealand. New Zealand is a wonderful place, and there's a lot of things going for it. But when you are starting a company, people investing in your company like you to be down the road from them. Because if things start going wrong, you start having issues, they don't want to have to go all the way to the other side of the world to come and sort it out, or even just to find out about it. They want to have a walk around, chat to new people and so on. And so for us, being in London was even considered quite far away from the Silicon Valley people. We brought them round to the idea in the end because they pass through London like once or twice a year.
But there's a very strong location effect, and that is something which is something that we need to really think about if you're trying to do some of these businesses in New Zealand. That's a key challenge, I think, you've got to face. There were many advantages of being in London. We could recruit a lot of people from around Europe because that's relatively close to home for them and so on. And so that was pretty well. One thing that I have come to appreciate a lot more is management. When I was a mathematics and computer science student at the University of Waikato, I did not fully appreciate management, it has to be said. The management students seem to spend a lot of time socializing with each other and so on. Turns out social skills are really, really important. And if you want to run a team of any size, management is incredibly important. And that is what makes teams work really, really well. I've ended up spending a lot of my time, some teams, doing management in one shape or form. So, any management students here in the audience, I have a much deeper appreciation than I used to of how important that subject is. Another thing which is really important is vision. It sounds like a very fluffy topic, but what I mean by this is being able to have a very clear goal in mind for an organisation, a clear vision of this, I guess, and being able to communicate that to people and get buy-in from the people in the group. And that will bind the people together, and it helps to get everybody sort of pulling in the right direction, because they all understand what the direction is, and hopefully they believe that this is a really good, worthwhile and exciting thing to be doing. And so I actually spend a lot of my time talking to my team and beating the drum and being an evangelist for artificial general intelligence of what we're doing. And I think that's a really important thing. Because if you get that right, then a lot of the other things sort of tend to work right by themselves, because people are into the right sort of topics. And then finally, timing. There are a lot of people have the right idea and try executing at the wrong time. And it's very hard to know what the right time is. But the tech industry is littered with people who basically had the right idea, but they tried doing it 5 years or 10 years too early and didn't get anywhere. And then later on, somebody else did it, and the technology was more mature, and then it was a huge, huge success. So this is a really difficult thing to do, but I think it's really, really critical, and it's something that we, by luck or by insight, it's unclear which it is, or some combination of those. And I think we got the timing really, really right on what we were trying to do there. You know, we were a bit ahead of the crowd. A lot of people thought we were too ambitious and too far ahead of our time. Turns out, a few years later, everything was taken off and we were just perfectly positioned to be there and take off with it. And with that, I would like to conclude my talk. Thank you.